Good afternoon and welcome. We have come together this late winter afternoon to acknowledge the death and to honor the life of Sheldon Brown. We gather confronting the fact that life does end. All generations bear this truth, but there is an end as well as a beginning. And each generation is supported in this by the love and care, honor and gratitude of those generations that precede and follow. So each of you, young and old, great and small, is a link in this chain of love and gratitude. To be together here, to be linked here on this day dedicated to the life and memory of Sheldon, this is good. We gather as family and old friends with sorrow in our hearts, yet we gather also in celebration. We come in grief with tears and sadness because Sheldon is no more with us. Yet we come in gratitude, thankful for Sheldon's legacy. In the next hour, we will know sadness as well as smiles, loss as hurt as well as laughter as relief. Our time together will include recollections from family and co-workers and friends, music and singing and dancing that Sheldon loved. And afterward, you are invited to a reception, a sharing of refreshments and good memories. May our time together honor well the passing and celebrate fully the life of Sheldon Brown and be a comfort and a blessing to each and all who have gathered here this day. And let there be dancing.
Thank you. initially, when Charles Hooker wrote the gun, after he passed me, I put on the power and caught up. It looked interesting. And I said the words that changed my life. "You're riding fixed gear, aren't you?" I still use the wheel and I made under his direction on our first date. We were married for 28 years and had two wonderful children, Toba and George. And thanks to Sheldon, they can both sing. When they were younger, and we were younger, we often traveled on kickback tandems that Sheldon had built out of solo bikes. Toba was usually Sheldon's stoker, person in the back, pedaling hard to get Daddy up the hills, while George rode behind me, usually refusing to pedal unless I fed him a constant stream of mount problems. And so we pedaled around New England, Wisconsin, French countryside, Quebec, singing and solving math problems. In 1991, we spent our vacation through Cape Cod on Quebec tandems, when Hurricane Bob turned to the Cape instead of Boston as predicted. We couldn't evacuate on our tandems, so we worked together to help prepare the Truro Youth Hostel for the impending storm. Whenever I think of us as a family, I go back to that day as we worked hard together, happy together, with this violent storm passing over and around us. And when the storm passed, and we had a good night's sleep, and Jam's gourmet grocery store ran out of French bread and pate, it was time to move on. We headed along the Cape, once more peddling, singing, and solving our problems. Most of you know that Sheldon loved to perform. His mother introduced him to community theater when he was a child. He was almost 50 when his children got him involved in performing again. It was George at 9 who discovered Mars dancing, and he and Toba joined Band the Red Cross. That in turn led to Toba getting into the children's chorus for the 1993 Midsummer Rebels, and Sheldon did his first Rebels performance a year later. Sheldon adored performing with his children. He and Toba both sang in the adult chorus of the Midsummer Rebels in 1994 and again in 1995 when George joined them in the children's chorus. I did costumes. I was there too. His Gilbert and Sullivan debut was with Toba in the MIT Gilbert and Sullivan Players 1995 production of the Mikado. Sheldon and George were pirates and policemen together in the MIT production in 1998 of Pirates of Penzance. Sheldon did many other performances with and without the kids in Rebels and in Gilbert and Sullivan. Sheldon joined the New England Shanty Singers when they started up in 2005. By this time, MS was already limiting his mobility, and the Shanty Sings were a great way for him to perform sitting down. He always prepared songs to read and had the words ready to pull up on his PDA. He was always happiest when Toba or George came along. He just beamed when either of them led a song. Despite increasingly debilitating MS, Sheldon did perform, mostly sitting down, in the 2005 Christmas Rebels, and at the time of his death, he was rehearsing the Sudbury Sabrinos for their recent production of Norman the Bard. On December 21st, 1995, Sheldon put up his first web page. There's a beginning to everything. It's a page for Harris Cyclery, and 4 days later, he put up his first personal page. The web was the perfect place for him to share his knowledge and love of bicycles, gadgets, music, theater, his family, well, he came first, really, science fiction, or anything else that caught his fancy. During the last 12 years, Sheldon's brilliance, knowledge, and humor have won fans around the world. Again, I thank you for being part of his life. We'll all remember him, and I miss him very, very much. Thank you.
When I was a baby, my dad held me in one hand. He was so big. We were so little. My brother and me, we were so little.
sit on his lap and even wrap his arms all around us. And we would feel so safe and warm. He would sing his songs and tell his stories about boats. He would sing his songs about boats and the ocean and sailing away to explore the world. We would always ask him questions, and he would always answer them very carefully. And he took our questions so seriously in a way that very few adults did when we were little kids. And he would tell us bedtime stories. One story he told us was the story about how airplanes work. He told us about how the wing curves and how the air pressure is different above and below the wing and how the air lifts up. We had an alphabet on the wall so we could learn to read when we were little, and my dad also put up on the wall a periodic table. And we would stare and look up at it and say, "Dad, can you show me the elements?" And he would pick us up, and he would say, "Okay," and he would point to the elements and tell us what they were called and how many electrons they had. And my favorite story that he would tell us at night was one that started off approximately like this. It would go, "You see, once upon a time, a long time ago, people thought that the right way to explore the universe was to sit and think very hard and to come up with ideas and write them down and say, this is true. But then Galileo said, well, shouldn't we be doing experiments to test our ideas?" And you know, the story went on about Galileo being this kind of folk hero, you know, fighting the establishment for science, for truth, for empiricism. And my dad was an atheist, and his atheism was never a lack of anything, you know. It was always a really strong belief in people, in our science, in the value of our thoughts, of our ideas, and our questions. My dad told me that when he was a kid, he went to church and he asked, "How did Adam and Eve have enough genetic diversity to found?" I don't know if there's a God, but if there is, I think my dad is probably arguing with him right now. I don't know if there's an afterlife. If there is, maybe he's very surprised. But I still feel like he's here. Like he hasn't faded from this universe even a little bit. And like I can still feel his hand on my back holding me up.
Sheldon chose me a song. He loved French song as much as I did. And he sent me a song and said, "I hope you'll learn this with me so we can sing it together." And I'll keep that promise. Anyone who knew Jack Langstaff, founder of the Rebels, knows the power of a great heart. Anyone who loves music knows its power to move hearts across time and space and across generations. And anyone who loves the sea Now with both pain and the loneliness of forces beyond our control, and the strength and peace of the eternal here with us. Sheldon chose his own sailor's farewell, and I would invite you to hear both the courage to face that great unknown, and yes, to love, the promise that love is stronger than death, and will return. The Virginie de la Rosier, je viens te faire mes adieux. Non, je ne pars pour l'Amérique, je m'en vais suivant le vent. Adieu donc, belle Virginie, les voiles sont déjà mises au vent. Les voiles au vent, mon cher amant, cela m'y cause bien de tourment. Il surviendra quelque temps bas et les orages sûrement. Il fera périr ton bâtiment et moi je resterai sans amant. Belle Virginie, ne craignant rien, je suis au premier marin. Il m'arrivera aucun naufrage pendant que je serai sur ces eaux. Belle Virginie, amorez-vous, sois fidèle à nos amours. Je te promets, oh ma mignonne, de revenir à ce pays.
I'm Arlene Esposen, Sheldon's big sister, and this is Richard Brown, his big brother. And listening to the beautiful music, I thought of something else I thought you might want to know about Sheldon that might connect to his love of the music of the sea. I just went back in the mental genealogy, and it's his great-grandfather who was around the world sailor, who sailed from the Scandinavian countries and went around the Cape of Good Hope or the Horn. I'm sorry, my geography is terrible, and led in Washington State. And so he comes from a world sailor. I know everyone here remembers Sheldon in different ways. The way that I remember him that's kind of unique to my experience is because he was my little brother. I always thought of him as my little brother forever. Richard and I first heard of Sheldon when our parents told us to expect a baby. And that was fine, we could handle another sibling. But then they told us that they were going to name the baby Sheldon, whether it was a boy or a girl. And our grandfather's name was Sheldon, and we thought, we're going to give a baby girl the grandfather's name? We thought parents were so dense, but we were pretty sure of that. Anyway, Richard being 10 years older, not quite 10 years older than Sheldon, and I'm 6 years older than Sheldon, once he became a toddler, he fell into our care a lot. And I often thought of him as my first child. It gave me an honor, though, that I share with no one, that I was the first person to bicycle with Sheldon. We we would, it would horrify modern parents, but when we grew up in Tarrytown, New York, about 2 miles from the Hudson River, and I had the bike I had inherited from Richard, a little boy's bike, and I would take, when I was 9, I would take little 3-year-old Sheldon and pull him around by the bar in the front of me, sit him side saddle on the bar, put his little hands on the handlebar, and off we would go those 2 miles to the sandy beach and spend the day. I gave him a really treat, though, during the part of the ride that was flat, because I could go no hands, and so I would tell him, Sheldon, now you're steering, and he would be 3 and holding those bars and so proud of himself that he could steer the bike himself. We had some great adventures, just one I wanted to mention to you. Richard had fixed up an old wooden rowboat, had a half horsepower motor on it. We had been out on it, you'll see there's a picture of the boat in the parish hall. We had been out on it with Richard on occasion, but one day Sheldon and I decided we would just take the boat out ourselves. So again, we're 2 miles from the river. We put it on the little cart. We pushed and pulled and dragged it down to the river and started the engine. It was a nice, reliable little engine. And we went. It's like, you know the Tappan Zee Bridge? It's about 4 miles across the river there. We went across the river, tied it up at the docks, did rock climbing and exploring and had a glorious day. And then came back and all was well, nothing failed. It was fun. He was a lovely little brother. I got to be a teenager, went to college, got married. Our lives got separate in many ways, but we always came back and touched base. He was always at the celebrations, at the weddings. He was always there. When I was sick, he was there to comfort me. He taught me millions of things. I still have the bicycle he made for me 40 years ago from an old French racing bike. He taught me how to do Photoshop and digital cloning. He was a wonderful person to have. And I know he's famous in the world of bicycles, but in my life, he was just my little brother. Simply wonderful, immensely valued little brother.
I painted my first portrait of Sheldon the year he visited me in upstate New York, where I was in college. That was the year that he turned from a pudgy little kid to a tall, handsome teenager. And to celebrate his new maturity, he took to wearing suits and ties. He was no bourgeois conformist. Even at 13, he announced to me in that visit that he was a communist. And I said, Sheldon, I know that you are seriously concerned about social justice. And I share that concern, and I want to talk to you more about it. But I have a book for you to read, and I think that will be an interesting perspective for you about what happened to the ideals of communism when dictators started corrupting them and their followers suffered. So I gave him a book by George Orwell, which dramatized the metaphorically that particular development. And Sheldon told me later that he was horrified at first when he saw the title of the book. He thought it was for little kids, Animal Farm. But he did read that book, and he found it so impressive that he read all of George Orwell's works, and Orwell became one of his literary heroes. Sheldon always had the courage of his convictions. He was a member of the NAACP, considered himself a feminist. He was a conscientious objector. He demonstrated against the war in Vietnam and burned his draft card. He was brave in his independent thinking. And as he matured, he grew mellower and wittier, as you, I'm sure many of you have experienced. I asked him once about his take on Boston politics. It's a contest in which a conventional white male politician was running against a bearded African-American activist. And Sheldon said, well, you know how people tend to favor the candidate who is most like themselves? And, well, I do favor the candidate who is most like me. I'm going for the guy with the beard.
According to our plan, at this point we're supposed to be having Sullivan, no Gilbert, but apparently neither Gilbert or Sullivan are here.
This afternoon honoring Sheldon Brown, but unfortunately the music director is ill and unable to organize a group for this service. Please proceed with Mr. Allen's presentation, and we're very glad to have known Sheldon in person.
We're delighted that you're here. We also know that you're in the middle of a production that, goodness knows, he would prefer to be in himself. Those of you who know the Love Chord will have the lyrics and music echoing in your ears as I invite John Allen to come forward.
Well, Sheldon was a hands-on sort of guy. As representative of bicycling community and his bicycling friends, I thought I'd give you a little hands-on demonstration here, something that Sheldon is about. First, just a little introduction. I've known him since I walked into the bike shop in Cambridge in 1972 or 73. And he stayed after closing time to fix a flat tire for me. I think I know something about bicycling. I'm fine with teaching riding technique. But Sheldon was always several steps ahead of me with his encyclopedic, thoughtful, imaginative, and independent perspective on anything that happened with bicycle selection, customization, maintenance, repair. Sheldon and I collaborated on many magazine articles and the book from 1981. This is not a promo, it's out of print. He shot most of the pictures and I wrote most of Now, for those of you who aren't the bicyclists, here's my little demonstration. Many things about bicycling are counterintuitive. Novice bicyclists think they're getting the best exercise by pushing hard, but spinning pedals works far better. A big soft bicycle saddle that heels would so comfortable as one that blisters your butt. To ride safely on the road, you don't hide from the traffic, you have to mix with the traffic a lot of the time. The front brake is the one you have to learn to use to get to the quickest, safest spot, and so on and on. But here's something I learned only last fall after having known Sheldon for 35 years. Most people think that if you want to carry a bicycle tire with you, when you're out touring, you should ruin your tire. You have to take an old tire like this. Yeah, they work, but they're maybe a little harder to put on the rim. And they're expensive. Now, for years, and I think I've been learning this, I've known that you could take a regular tire and roll it up. But here's counterintuitive thing. Most people sort of try to fold it into two loops, and it doesn't want to do that. It twists the bead, right? Harriet. Well, you can twist it into not two loons, but if you try to get them in three loons, there are ghosts. But notice, I'm trying to raise them, so I'm fine. There are ghosts. I've been in there twice full back. Okay, but this is not the end of the story, because that's the way I used to do it. Last fall, Sheldon and I set out to put together a series of video clips, and we only got to do this one. And I saw Sheldon did. And this is just so difficult. Everything I do about bicycles, he has some little additional trick. And it's so cool, and that I've never seen before. He said, see, I have my hands opposite each other. Put your hands at 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. Bring them together. Hold the tire with one hand. Then you roll the other part of it. And one loop and two loops. And look, I've done it without having to get the tire dirt on my clothes. That's what I learned from Sheldon in October. And then he said, well, once you've done with this, take a couple of toe straps and tie it so it won't come flying up. He said this only works with red toe straps. There's another question. I won't deal with the two toe straps, just not to take any longer. If you really want to see the real thing, it's on his website. Just Google on Sheldon Brown Tire. So now I'm going to go on and write and make more video clips, but I won't have Sheldon to turn to for the fine points. And there'll be some of those fine points I'm going to miss. So I'm with Sheldon.
As many of you know, Sheldon collected quotes from thinkers and tinkers, great and small, and attached these quotes to his emails and articles. If you look at the whole wealth of those quotes, you get a good sense of Sheldon's sensibilities on a number of subjects, and most certainly you get a sense of his humor. I have a sampling to offer you that only gives you a glimpse of his homegrown insight. Most of the quotes that Sheldon selected were, of course, philosophical. He cited Emerson, who said, when it is dark enough, you can see the stars. Nearly all of the quotes were funny, of course, dry and subtle funny, as this quote from Sir Winston Churchill, in which Winston observes that man will occasionally stumble over the truth, but most of the time, he will pick himself up and continue on. These living hairy turtle doves insistent words that time shouldn't just pass, things should happen. He was fond of quotes that described humanity's frailties and flaws. He chose the words of Harlan Ellison, who observed the two most common elements in the universe. These, no doubt, were on Toba's wall as a child. The two most common elements in the universe are hydrogen and stupidity. But he also included Henry Ford, who promised, whether you think that you can or that you can't, you are usually right. No surprise that Sheldon's choice of quotes often reflected his interest in how things work. He quoted Andrew Tannenbaum, who said, the nice thing about standards is that there are so many of them to choose from. A frequent favorite was Robert Heinlein, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, who observed, never worry about theory as long as the machinery does what it's supposed to do. Another favorite was Douglas Adams, you know, from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Sheldon quoted his line, the major difference between a thing that might go wrong and a thing that cannot possibly go wrong is that when a thing that cannot possibly go wrong goes wrong, it usually turns out to be impossible to get out or repair. Sheldon's own words were frequently among the quotes he cited. No doubt you read George Bernard Shaw, who said, "I often quote myself, it adds spice to my conversation." But in one of Sheldon's quotes, he cautioned that in theory there's no difference between theory and practice, but in practice there is. Understanding how things work in practice is a whole lot harder. Sheldon suggested this with a Japanese proverb: "If you understand everything," he quoted, "you must be misinformed." He conveyed this grasp of mystery to Tova, who he quoted having said, "If you memorize a mathematical formula without understanding it, it's like you're learning a negative amount of math." Sheldon noted, as Mark Twain had, that "I have never let my schooling interfere with my education." And for all his savvy with the computer, he agreed with Frank Zappa, who cautioned that the computer can't tell you the emotional story. It can give you the exact mathematical design, but what's missing is the eyebrows. Other of Sheldon's quotes tended to the political, usually cynical, but sometimes hopeful. He liked Abby Hoffman's advice that the first duty of a revolutionary is to get away with it. He also quoted Dwight and David Eisenhower when he said, "Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired, signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, from those who are cold and are not clothed. This world in arms is not spending money alone, it is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, and the hopes of its children." More recently, he commented on immigration, saying, "As far as I know, none of my immigrant ancestors arrived with a passport, a visa, or a work permit." As Tova mentioned, Sheldon wasn't exactly on speaking terms with the Almighty. Like Woody Allen, he could observe, "To you, I'm an atheist. To God, and I'm a loyal opposition." So it's surprising, then, that not a few of his quotes opined about God's intentions. He quoted Ambrose Bierce, who observed that war is God's way of teaching Americans geography. In what I believe were Sheldon's own words, he theorized that if it was God's purpose to create humanity in his own image, we must conclude that he is omniscient, omnipotent, and incompetent. He quoted Benjamin Franklin, apparently agreeing with Ben, when he said, "Beer is living proof that God loves us and wants us to be happy." Of course, a lot of Sheldon's quotes were life-related. "I still feel," he quoted, "that variable gears are only for people over 45. Isn't it better," he went on, "to triumph by the strength of your muscles than by the artifice of a derailleur? We are getting soft." And so Sheldon agreed with Henri de Grandes when he said, "As for me, give me a fixed gear." Regardless of bicycle type, Sheldon's passion for the creative, even transformative power of bicycles was boundless and contagious. His list of quotes includes this wistful passage from no less than Ernest Hemingway: "It is by riding a bicycle that you learn the contours of the country best, since you have to sweat up the hills and coast down them. Thus you remember them as they actually are." But he also quoted the words of Albert Einstein, who confessed that many of his ideas I thought of while I was riding my bicycle. As for bicycle construction and maintenance, you all know well the quote, I believe, from Keith Bondranger. Sheldon knew he was right when he said, "Light, cheap, durable, choose any two." The best of the bicycle quotes were Sheldon's own words. "Nobody who has anything to do with bicycles," he admitted, "has all of their marbles. Everyone I know in bicycling is at least a little bit crazy." And he rightly noted, I think, when he said, all present company included. He cautioned, coasting is a pernicious habit, as well as the lower your gear, the more of your riding time will be spent going uphill. And he promised, bicycling isn't supposed to hurt. Sheldon's fierce interest in music and theater was represented by some of the quotes on his list. He knew Roger Kipling was exactly right when he said, music is as good as talking to them that understand. And Sheldon knew that Shauna Casey saw deep into our hearts when he said, all the world's a stage, and most of us are desperately under-rehearsed. Sheldon's selected quotes included a few marvelous ditties and some great poetry too, like his words from Lord Byron, which capture well what we know now, sadly, to be true of Sheldon himself. Byron writes, so we'll go no more a-roving so late into the night, though the heart be still as loving and the moon be still as bright. Those of you who knew Sheldon well will know that Sheldon's choice of these words by Thomas Edison were likely biographical. Edison said, I never did a day's work in my life. It was all fun. And more, that his appropriation for his own purposes of this common political advertisement quote was vintage Sheldon. He quoted, I'm Sheldon Brown, and I approve this message. Yes, vintage Sheldon, his wits, his whimsy, his wisdom shall be sorely missed.
And the emails were coming in, and the phones were ringing, and he's answering questions. I must say, he was a very busy person, continuously. I was finally able to simply say to him, Sheldon, I'm leaving and I'm going to be gone for about 3 months. And he looked at me and said, 3 months? I thought you were going for about 2 or 3 weeks. I said, no, I'm going to be away for about 3 months. He said, well, that's wonderful. And he got up and he came over to me, and of course I extended my hand as I always would with everybody else. And all of a sudden, these two arms were around me, pressing me. I think that I must have been able to find out what the Sheldon Bear Hug would be. But I'll tell you, it was something. If I never had one, I suggest it would have been wonderful for me to feel this. I didn't think much of it at that moment because, well, I was leaving, and I thought it was very nice of him to do that. But when I came back, my goodness, the bear hug was there. Following year when I left, the bear hug. Coming back, the bear hug, so on and so forth. I didn't realize that this past December would be the final bear hug, Sheldon. When I was in Florida, I got a call from my son about what had happened. And I started to think, when somebody puts their arms around you that way, and presses you, there's got to be some meaning to it. And of course, I started to think about it. And obviously, I made everything nice to me. I kind of thought maybe Sheldon was trying to say a few things to me, such as, Sonny, you know, you're a pretty good guy. I sort of like working here. I like working with the staff, also his friends. He gave me the freedom to do what I want. He seemed to appreciate that, and he told me that more than once to begin with. So I sort of felt that he was thanking me. And then I started to think to myself again, why is he thanking me? I need to thank him for what he did for me, and for this little business that we have. So I'd like to just take one moment. For the look up and say, Sheldon, you are going to be missed so desperately. You're going to be missed by me and the many people that you've touched, your family, everyone. You'll always be with me. And I thank you so very much. Oh, and I'm going to miss you so terribly.
Any gathering like this shows us all something huge about the person we've gathered to celebrate. Look at all of us. Look at this wonderful group of people with such a diverse range of interests, of passions, of loves. That's not part of my prepared remarks. Any sudden death is a shock to those of us left behind, a sharp reminder of our own mortality, especially if we're getting older, and a snatching away that leaves us bereft and unfulfilled, unable to have said goodbye. Sheldon's abrupt exit was the easiest way for him to go, and yet hard on those who loved him by virtue of its very suddenness. The shock is especially severe, I think, because Sheldon was so much with us, in the warmth and benevolence of his personality, in his remarkable willingness, even after MS, had made getting about more awkward, to travel so that he could be with his friends. In all the good things he did for so many people, in the open book of his day-to-day life that any of us could read and view on the web. I forgot to bring up his crown. I have it in my... Daphne, would you hold it up? This crown. Sheldon wore this crown 12 weeks ago when he sang the part of Good King Wenceslas at a Christmas sing, as he had done many times over the preceding 14 years. This particular sing was held at 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon in the central Massachusetts town of Petersham, some 75 miles west of the Brown Fell home. Shelton and Harriet had tickets for a Boston Symphony Orchestra concert that evening. And yet, there they were at Petersham at 3. That was Shelton, and that is Harriet. They left a bag of their stuff by mistake when they took off for Boston, and we were going to use its return as an excuse for a visit sometime early this year. This too was Shelton. In the mid-1990s, I was offered a reed organ, free, if I would pick it up myself. The wrinkles were that the organ was in a house on Nantucket Island, and I had no vehicle large enough to accommodate the instrument. How did Shelton discover my need? In any case, it was Shelton who drove with me in his truck down to the ferry, then to the house on Nantucket, loaded the organ into the truck, drove back to the ferry, then to my house, unloading the organ and putting it in place. Along the way, we named the organ Tova, after a talented and passionate young musician we both admired. Shelton's death hit me very hard, and of course I'm not alone in this. When I finally let the grief surface washing the dishes one morning, I wept and wept and heard myself saying, "Goodbye, old friend. Goodbye, old friend. You were my Papa Bear. You were a good friend. Goodbye, old friend." Even though we're lacking Shelton's fine, deep bass voice, let's sing a round he might have enjoyed. It's going to take a little bit of doing. I'm sure Shelton would be patient with the setting up here. It's called Appalachian Round. The words are in your service, order of service. Music is from Elizabethan England. The words are by a mid-20th century poet named George Furse.
This is part one, part two, part three, part four. But don't worry, folks, the safety in numbers. And what I suggest, who knows Appalachian Round? If you're looking at this round, they're all together first.
And from Canada, thanks for always answering my stupid questions. Amid these messages and expressions of gratitude, there are many farewells. Ride on, Sheldon, pedal on. Ride in peace, safe travels, Sheldon. May you forever cycle on in a world without potholes, headwinds, or punctures. Ride free, Sheldon, with strong legs, endless bike lanes, and no cars. Godspeed, Captain Bike. From all these gathered gratitudes, let comforting compassion flourish in us. From all our farewells, let healing come and lives be inspired. The poet Mary Oliver reminds that to live in this world, you must be able to do three things: to love what is mortal, to hold it against your bones, knowing your whole life depends on it, and when the time comes to let it go, let it go. We let go, but first we give thanks for the life of Sheldon Brown, for the times we shared and enjoyed with him, for the passion he had for fine words, for bicycles, for music, for theater, for dancing and singing, for his family and his companions. We give thanks for his life and his legacy, for what has been forever. The life and the spirit of Sheldon Brown, we lift our gratitude. And in the silence of his absence, let us be assured that while his life has ended, in memory and in spirit and in us, he shall live on. In silence then, together, let us raise our gratitude. service and more marvelous music from our friends at the Brothers.